Hello everyone. I'm so inspired by Sawa's speech, and what he said is kind of resonates with me because I'm talking about one of my passions and how it can help us. And so how I've tried to make my story is just resonate it as much as possible to from where I come from and what I went through and how it could be improved moving forward. So well, for me, it started in the winter of 2020. I get this email from Isade saying, "Big things start with a yes." That was my approval mail for the MBA. I'm super excited, okay? And now Isade is like, "Hey, you gotta pay the first deposit." I'm like, "Shit." Okay. I'm gonna do that. Now, all my savings are in rupees, right? The amount to be paid is euros. I go on the internet trying to find the safest and the cheapest option to do that. And when I do, I pay conversion fees, transaction fees, and whatnot. Well, if not all of us, I'm assuming some of you have been in a position, we have transacted in a foreign currency and paid those annoying fees. Well, wouldn't it be a great idea if everyone transacted in the same currency using a mechanism that was safe, completely decentralized, and did I mention no one could hack it? Well, the answer is blockchain. That's the mechanism. And the currency that's based on that mechanism is cryptocurrency. Okay. But we are very used to the fiat banks, no? We feel secure. I can see that financial institution. I know where my money is. Okay, done. Well, I have no money in my wallet right now. Does that mean I have no money? Actually, true, I don't have any money. But I left my job, so I'm absolutely broke at this point. But I do have a mobile app on my phone that says, yeah, you have a few hundred euros. Okay. The point that I'm trying to make with this example is that money inherently has no value. It has value because we have decided it should. And because we have decided that, it does. Money isn't anything objective, it's a story we tell each other about exchange and transfers. It's a collective fiction, and that's a really powerful concept. Well, now if you come back to the financial institutions, they all work so well because they solve this one very big problem. It's called the double spending problem. Now, what is the double spending problem? Okay. When you email me a document, or you email me a presentation, or you send something to someone, it's most probably a copy. Okay. But if you're transferring your friend $100, you better not still have those $100 with you. That's the double spending problem. Banks solve it by having one centralized server that cross-verifies each transaction. Blockchain, however, does it differently. And that's what makes it so secure and so unhackable. How does blockchain work? What I want you to do is look at the person to your left. And look at the person to your right now. Imagine this is your seating arrangement for the rest of your life. So now, if one day the person on your left shows up with a different haircut or starts behaving weirdly odd, right? You would notice that. That's the core principle behind blockchain. It consists of various blocks, and every block has the same information. So when a transaction goes through, every block needs to verify that transaction. So if you tamper or hack one block, it conveys a different information than the rest of the blocks, and the whole transaction fails. This is important because global payment losses have went up from 9 billion to 32 billion in 2020. Payment fraud will reach 40 billion in 2027, and that's a very big amount. People are getting ripped off. But now, how does blockchain create prosperity for us? This is a very, very financially driven talk. How is that creating a chance of wealth equality? Okay, the first Internet of Things, it brought us a lot of wealth. It made a lot of people rich. But it also brought social inequality with it. And that's the core of the anger that we have inside, no? What if there is a way to recreate wealth, to pre-distribute it? Because right now, the only way we have to distribute wealth is to tax people and spread it around. What I'm proposing to you is, what if we change how wealth is created in the first place? Wouldn't that be powerful? So being a typical MBA consultant, I'll tell you three ways. Now, first way, you're a farmer in a developing country. You have a title to your land. A dictator comes in and says, okay, fair, you have a title to your land, but I have a computer system that says the land belongs to my friend. The farmer is absolutely ripped off. And I'm not making this problem on the top of my head. This actually happened to people in Honduras. They were ripped off because the title to their land and the title in the system were different. Hernando de Soto is a great Latin American economist, and he said the number one issue in today's economic mobility, more important than having a bank account, is having a title to your land. Because if you don't have a valid title to your land, you cannot borrow against it. You cannot plan ahead. So today, governments are working with companies to put land titles on blockchain. And once it's on blockchain, it's immutable. You cannot hack it. No one can alter it. And that creates prosperity for billions of people. Secondly, I want to talk about these companies called Airbnb and Uber. We love them. Well, I don't. They pride themselves on sharing economy. Hey, we all will go together, you know? I say the only reason these guys are successful is because they don't share. These large Silicon Valley disruptors can be disrupted. What I propose to you is an alternate app. Let's call it Isar Airbnb. Where you go, you're an owner, you have a nice house, you put that house on that app. The app obviously works on blockchain, come on. Now, you put your house on the app, and someone who's looking for a house goes there, selects it, signs the contract on blockchain, makes the payment on blockchain. Everything is there on that secure server. You cannot change it. Once it's there, it's immutable. Now, how does this translate to a real life problem? Because Airbnb is doing just fine. But this actually happens in India. Right now, there are $10 billion stuck in property disputes where people have different contracts. Blockchain can ideally solve it. Number three, you know the largest amount of money moved from a developed country to a developing country is not capital investment. It's not even foreign aid. It's people like me trying to pay back home. It's foreign remittance. It's a $40 billion market. And people are getting ripped off. So essentially, the ripped off are already getting ripped off. And this can be solved if they don't have to pay transaction fees or conversion fees, what I had to do in the first place. Now, technology doesn't create prosperity. People do. My case to you here is the technology genie is escaping from the bottle once again. It is giving us another kick at the can, another opportunity to rewrite the economic power grid and the old order of things and solve one of the world's most difficult problems if we will it. Ladies and gentlemen, what I propose to you is to go home with an idea of social equality, an idea of prosperity, an idea that will stand even when financial institutions fall down, an idea of one world, one currency, one technology. Thank you.